Good afternoon and welcome to the IONL November Lunch and Learn on Civility Toolkit Resources to Empower nurse Leaders to Identify, Intervene, and Prevent Workplace Bullying. My name is Christina and I am with IONL. I just want to alert you of a few housekeeping notes before we get started. First, due to the number of people registered, your line will be muted throughout the broadcast. If at any time you have a question, please type it in the question box and we will answer as many questions as we can at the end of the webinar. Secondly, an email link to the evaluation will be sent to you after the webinar. At the end of the evaluation, please type in your name and email so we will then be able to send you the CE certificate. We appreciate any feedback provided. So with that, I would like to introduce our presenters for this afternoon's webinar, Beth and Rita. Beth is a professor at Rush University College of Nursing, and Rita is the president and CEO of Innovative and Inclusive Global Solutions. Beth and Rita, now I'd like to turn it over to you.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Rita K. Adeniran. As Kristen mentioned, I'm the president and CEO of Innovative and Inclusive Global Solutions. Today, we will be discussing nurse leaders' role in promoting civil environments by mitigating and ultimately eliminating bullying. To begin, I'd like to quickly introduce you to five other members of our team who worked on our project. The PACES, as you will see, is an acronym that stands for Passionate About Creating an Environment of Respect and Civility. And it is a seven-member team, which is a subgroup of the 212 Robert Wood Johnson Foundation Executive Nurse Fellow. All seven members self-select to join the team with the goal of mitigating bullying and creating and sustaining healthy work environment. As nurses or members of the healthcare team, we understand incivility presents a threat to patient safety. In addition, showing respect for individual or groups is central to the profession of nursing and healthcare in general. Every member of our team has a unique story about bullying, and they made a commitment, a professional commitment and personal commitment to do everything they can in their power to facilitate environment of respect for everyone. Let's go to the next slide. As you will see, incivility or bullying is prevalent in nursing. Just looking at the headlines that this concept have made. The consequence of bullying is detrimental because bullying behaviors create toxic environment, having serious implications for healthcare, both for patients, staff, and clinicians. According to Shipps and McCurry 212, bullying erodes job satisfaction and morale and increase absenteeism in the profession. Johnson and Rea 2009 reported that 21% of nursing turnover is associated with bullying. Also, one in three new RNs that leave the profession altogether do so because of bullying. In one study conducted by the Bureau of National Affairs, they concluded that the loss in productivity due to workplace bullying amounts to almost $6 billion a year. Mounting evidence continues to indicate that incivility or bullying contributes significantly to the pervasive disrespect in healthcare, limiting clinicians' ability to deliver safe, quality healthcare. I'm sure possibly most of you are familiar with the articles, the landmark articles published by Lishon Lip and his colleagues in 212, titled Part 1 and Part 2 of A Culture of Respect. In that article, Lip and colleagues affirm disrespect in healthcare is a threat to patient safety and also informed us that creating a culture of respect is the essential first step in an healthcare organization's journey to become a safe, high reliability organization that provides supportive a nurturing environment and workplace that enables engagement. As NOS leaders, we are always looking for opportunities to better engage our staff, our clinicians, physicians, groups in organizational activities. As our nation healthcare evolves, relying on nursing as a key player in shaping the future of this country's healthcare, opportunity exists to support nurse leaders in their effort to eliminate bullying. Next slide. Now, I've talked a little bit about bullying, incivility, and I've used those terms interchangeably. I'd like to quickly define what is meant by bullying or incivility. In the literature, the term bullying has been defined with different names, including horizontal hostility, lateral or horizontal violence, workplace incivility, mobbing, nurse-to-nurse aggression, etc. Whatever you call it, the word is really encompassing. And also, in the literature, few definitions exist to describe bullying or incivility. We as a team, we selected to use, when I say we, I mean the PACERS, a simple definition which describes bullying as any workplace negative behavior that demonstrates a lack of regard for other workers. So any behavior that disregards other workers or try to disrespect. So a few examples of bullying are listed in this slide, inclusive of harassment, passive aggressiveness, and much more. The list goes on. As devaluing the input of others also, or scapegoating individuals, a practice that we've known in nursing, and the term that is very familiar with us, that nurses eat their young ones, is one of those things that fall into the category of bullying or incivility. At this time, I would like to go and talk about the state of the science. What did we find out in the literature? The statistics are really disturbing. For example, as you can see, 35% of adult Americans, this is beyond just nursing or healthcare, which 54 million workers report had been bullied. If this is even worse, if bullying is occurring in healthcare, because if we really look at the healthcare environment, when patients come to us, they're looking for looking to get better. If the healthcare environment is not welcoming and ready to affirm the power of the heal to get better, then why does the already burden come? As clinicians, leaders in healthcare, we really should think about this. And that's one of the reasons we really want to not only mitigate bullying, but eliminate bullying. Next slide, few more statistics. These statistics are really troubling. I'd like to read one for you. Nurses who survive bullying early in their careers tend to carry on these learned behaviors with them. They accept bullying as a culture and eventually choose to bully others. This may be conscious or unconscious. So really, it is really pervasive because people tend to follow what they experience or become what they see. So bullying has really become a culture that nurses learn, and we would like to break that cycle of that culture. Next slide, please. A few more troubling statistics. I won't go over this all over, but I wanted to share these statistics with you. So next slide, please. This next slide, what it does is that it shares some of the manifestations of bullying, which really presents barrier to safe quality care. So people that suffer bullying tend to manifest acute or chronic anxiety, depression, sleep interruption, fatigue, and lack of mental focus. If you put all these conditions together, it's a recipe for disaster in the clinical area. Next slide, please. And some of the effects of bullying, the negative effects of bullying are captured in the literature and discussed extensively. Inattentive healthcare professionals are more prone to making errors, and when self-doubt arises, people lose their confidence and really can cause catastrophic outcomes, which we are all really working to eliminate in healthcare. Next slide, please. Again, the cost is prohibitive. Spending $6 billion a year on bullying is something really that we can redirect those funds to channel those funds to doing greater and better things, not just for patients, even for professionals. Next slide, please. In addition to the cost, there are other imperatives that require us as nurse leaders to deal with bullying. First is the Joint Commission. I like to see the Joint Commission as the policeman of the hospital. All of us working in healthcare, if you are created by the Joint Commission, you know the type of feelings it evokes if Joint Commission is coming. So really, there's a accrediting mandate or imperative to be able to deal efficiently with bullying in our organization. Nursing Code of Ethics is mandate us to report unethical behavior, which bullying is one of them. The ANA principles also guide us in promoting work environment to mitigate and ultimately eliminate bullying. Even the magnet organizations requirements. So I could go on the list. But more than anything else, as clinicians, nurses, isn't an ethical imperative for us to create environment where everyone is respected? Next slide, please. So why is bullying so pervasive? Because if we all know that this is something that needs attention, why does it continue to move? Why is bullying still exist in the workplace? More importantly, in nursing, where the public really have over and over ranked us to be the best and most honest profession. So this here is the problem. Bullying and incivility have existed in healthcare for a long time, and it takes a conscious lens and mind to recognize the problem. As I said earlier, if it's a culture, people become blind to it and don't even see it anymore. And especially the subtle variations of it. Fear is a big barrier to acting. Often victims and bystanders do not know how to handle the situation, so they may resort to avoiding as a strategy. That's why some have referred to bullying as a silent crime, because victims are afraid to speak out for fear of retribution, believing nothing will change. If it's the culture, why do I do something about it? So victims are often disempowered by those factors. Nurse leaders also that would like to do something to break the cycle of bullying and incivility may not be able, because it's really not clear. There are no standard policies or really strong policies to be able to use to direct disciplinary actions. Also, human resource departments, we all know as leaders in healthcare, do not align with nursing thought processes, not because they don't want to take actions, but because it's not clear. The lack of clarity is really a big issue, and the lack of support can interfere with nurse leaders trying to do something about it. And also, another problem is that we found in the literature that approaches to eliminate bullying has been fragmented. Let's go to, thank you, Beth. Has been fragmented, centered on individuals, while ignoring the broader context of its occurrence. That includes influence from interpersonal, community, environmental, and policy sources. And the cultures that actually have established an environment where bullying truly occurs. So examples of strategies that individuals, including nurse leaders, have used in the past include isolated strategies like zero tolerance policies, cognitive rehearsal strategies, restorative justice, aggression minimization program, peer group learning communities. While those strategies, to some extent, have been relatively successful, they're not hold on for the long time, they're not sustainable. So as a strategy for us, one of the things that we as a group, the Pacers, wanted to do was to identify strategies that's going to hold on, not just deal with the problem for a short time. So while some of the strategies often were short-lived, we found that the socio-economic ecological model was more comprehensive strategy, and that was what we selected to guide the development of our toolkit, which Beth, Dr. Balik, will be discussing in detail in a few minutes. So let's talk a little bit more about the framework of solution that we selected, this social ecological model. This social economical model of human behavior was developed from the field of sociology, psychology, education, health, and it focuses on the nature of people's interaction with others and their environment. The model underscores that human behaviors are not isolated events. They are linked and influenced by other behaviors and social norms. For example, Hutchison and colleagues reported that organization factors serve as a mechanism through which bullying becomes embedded in the culture. Just think about the operating room where doctors are often viewed as God. Whatever they say goes on. And sometimes when they yell on nurses or other staff members, people often don't question it because they have a reputation. That's the behavior that that surgeon do. And people tend to accept it. It becomes the culture of that environment. And new nurses or staff that comes to the organization just accept that status quo. Oh, that is Dr. Bully. It's okay. That's what others are speak to people. So when that type of culture is established, it becomes a problem. And if we do not have a comprehensive strategy to address it, if you go on an individual level, it's often chocolate. So in support of Hutchison, several other researchers, including Brophy Fabrenner and Katrina, they stated why individual factors may play a role that contributes to bullying. The environment is a powerful force that consciously or unconsciously enables the act of bullying. So what this means is that educating individuals to be civil when the environments are not supportive is ineffective. Making sustainable behavioral change is elusive with focusing on individuals. So scientific evidence and scientific and anecdotal evidence suggests leadership conscientiousness in implementing comprehensive, coercive, and integrated bullying prevention is the most effective way to reduce bullying and sustain cultures of civility. I would like to quickly talk a little bit more about the social ecological model. Next. Thank you. So what does the social ecological model offer us? The social ecological model combines individual, interpersonal, community, environmental, and policy level solutions to addressing bullying. The model guided the development of the PACER Civility Toolkit to support nurse leaders in creating and sustaining environment of respect and civility. The model accentuates the fact that human behavior does not happen in a vacuum. As individuals exist and interact with a complex ecological system, the model underscores the nature of people's interaction with others and their environment in addressing bullying. Human behaviors often occur from a complex interaction between the individual, their families, their communities, and society in which they live. Human natural environment includes not the only corporal surroundings, but also social and cultural forces. Thus, individual behavior, competence, or problems are reflected in properties of an integrated system, not just their individual characteristics. This is one of the reasons that fragmented individualized approach have not been very successful. Some argued the limited success of current anti-bullying program is a result of failure to direct solutions that address the social ecology of bullying that goes beyond the individual. So bullying occurs not only because of the individual bullying characteristics, but also the action of peers, bystanders, leaders, and the acceptable norms in that environment, the culture, and also the community at large. So what we are saying as PACER and what we use to guide the development of the PACER toolkit is the social ecological model, touching from the individual, which is the intrapersonal level, to the interpersonal, that is the relationship of the individuals to their immediate environment, including the institutional level, the community or the culture, breaking that cycle, that cultural cycle of bullying, as well as the policy level. SEM understands the imperative for a multi-level and multi-pronged approach. The PACER Civility Toolkit is targeted to all levels, using multi-pronged strategies for assessment, prevention, monitoring, intervention, and recovery. At this time, I will turn the presentation over to Dr. Beth Bolis to discuss how the PACER team have used the socio-ecological model framework to develop the Civility Toolkit to empower nurse leaders in addressing bullying in healthcare organizations and beyond. Thank you for listening. We will please reserve questions to the end after Dr. Bolis finishes our presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Rita.
Welcome.
The toolkit is available at stopbullyingtoolkit.org and stopbullyingtoolkit.com. It's an expandable toolkit. We will continue to be adding tools, and it's already been downloaded in 23 countries in 5 continents. As you can see from our logo, it's based on the moral compass, respectful civil conduct or code to live by. This toolkit is specifically intended for use with students during their preparation for careers in healthcare and for employers to use with new hires during their onboarding experience. However, it can be used for anyone of any profession working to build a respectful workplace. So what do we have in the toolkit? We have an introduction that Rita wrote that really walks through how the various buckets are aligned with the socio-ecological model and how you can use them. That's available on the first page and in the upper toolbar. The toolkit then is divided into 4 buckets of truth, wisdom, courage, and renewal. And we're going to go through those buckets now. The buckets are not in any particular order and are to be used as needed. Let's look at the truth bucket first. Lucian Leap wrote, "A culture of disrespect is a barrier to patient safety and quality of care." In this bucket, we provide tools to measure where we are personally in our units or departments and in our organizations. Knowing where we are and where we want to be will guide our work. In every situation of incivility or bullying will be the collaborators. These are the receivers and givers of the disrespect and the bystanders. To build a culture of civility and respect, leaders must address the incivility for both the collaborators and the bystanders. The impact on the bystanders should not be minimized. Bystanders, who are these people? They can be the other healthcare professionals or the patients, families, visitors in the setting. Bystanders can experience all the same negative effects as collaborators and need to see that the values of the organization are lived. Culture is transparent. Everyone is part of it, and everyone contributes to it. In this toolkit bucket are assessments, indices, and a dashboard for you to select from to find out where you are in the incivility and bullying spectrum. Do you experience it but not speak up? Do you speak up but not feel listened to? Or are you a perpetrator? And most of us at some time or another have been. Self-reflection is an important tool for change. Several assessments, including those by Dr. Cynthia Clark, a leading expert in the field, have been provided for you to download from the toolkit. They have been provided with permission, but require attribution for use. In the toolkit, I mentioned there's a dashboard. It was written by Dr. Cole Edmondson and Joyce Lee from Texas Health Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas. It's a micro and macro tool using different metrics readily available to you in your organizations. This tool can be modified for the particular organization that you are in. Turnover, how long they want to stay on the unit, their average tenure on the unit. Variance reports, what already has been reported for incivility or bullying. Call-in history, and we saw that that physiological response is a strong one. But what you might not have thought about is a float survey, the Heavenly Seven. And this is where their innovation has really taken us to a new level. The Heavenly Seven, think of this as the canary in the mine. You know, who are the people in your organization that may feel marginalized or not treated well, who are disrespected? And in a major academic medical center, it's often the float pool. So look at the Heavenly Seven questions that they have here. I felt welcome on the unit. Someone offered help when I needed it. If I floated again, I would enjoy going back there. I had the resources I needed and the support I needed to complete my assignment. I saw a good culture there. I saw people who expressed appreciation for each other. They showed concern for my well-being, and I really received appreciation for my work. So if these don't apply to your particular organization or setting, you know, our challenge to you is to determine your own Heavenly Seven and start a dashboard. The wisdom bucket. Sir Francis Bacon said, knowledge is power. So in this bucket, what we have for you are, what is it? You know, we just heard, but your organization or your students need to hear it. So we have brief fact sheets that can be downloaded for use. Then what happens if, despite all of our work and best intentions, the incivility and bullying continues? Well, Rita already mentioned this a little bit. Many organizations write no tolerance policies to determine repercussions of incivility and bullying. However, caution should be taken in how these are crafted. If the discipline policy escalates too quickly, students and staff may choose not to report for fear of destroying someone's career. Patients and family may not report staff for fear of receiving poor care or no care when they need it. Alternatively, if every incident is handled with a simple conversation over coffee, real change may not occur. Thus, a balanced approach is needed, and policies must be written to start with respectful conversations that lead to severe disciplinary action, including termination of employment, should disruptive behaviors continue. The next bucket is our courage bucket. Theodore Roosevelt said, knowing what's right doesn't mean much unless you do what's right. So in this bucket, we provide materials so that you can learn to respectfully manage conversations regarding incivility or bullying in our workplaces. And we start with a mnemonic, be aware and care. Emotions and tensions can often run high with the increasing acuity of many settings and the numerous stressors, especially for productivity, that we all face today in healthcare. But how we handle these situations defines who we are. This mnemonic, be aware and care, will help you stay focused to the task to reduce incivility and bullying in the workplace. A printable sheet is available in the Courage bucket and should be downloaded and posted in every healthcare area. So what does it stand for? Bullying exists. And as Rita mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, bullying is the most common type of violence in contemporary U.S. society. It can exist at any level of your organization. Bullies can be superiors, subordinates, and colleagues. Bullying is a real problem in healthcare and becomes a major issue if it's ignored or unchecked. Call it what it is. It can lead to a loss of valuable human capital and medical errors. Acknowledge that bullying may be a problem in your organization. Healthcare leaders should talk about bullying and encourage staff, students to speak up and be heard if it does happen. The more it's acknowledged, the more you can do about it. Leaders that minimize its impact or deny its existence create a culture of silence that impedes solutions to the problem. Watch for the signs of the bullying throughout the workplace. Be proactive. Be sure supervisors, managers, and faculty know how to recognize the signs of bullying. Don't wait for it to be brought to your attention. But if it does occur, act. Act when you notice the signs of bullying by directly intervening or getting help if you don't know how. Bullies lose their power when people stop passively accepting their behavior. Refuse to be a silent bystander. It is everyone's responsibility to have the courage to play a key role to prevent and stop bullying. Get involved and take a stand against the issue. Reflect on the incident and your action. Reflect on what was perceived to go wrong and start to reflect on what worked well and why. Analyzing the incident may help you to reflect on action, the past experience. Reflect in action as an incident happens, and reflect for action, actions you might choose to take in future interactions. And then, of course, care, because it really does matter. Code words, have you ever used one? They can work really, really well. In our project team, we used the term ouch. Our team was passionate on this subject and very conscious not to be incivil or disrespectful to each other. And yet, periodically, even for us, we had to use our code word with each other. When we heard it, we paused, we reflected, and we apologized. Code words can be used between two people. They can be used among a group of people, a unit. You could have a code word for your whole organization. So think what code word works best in your setting. It's often best if the people using the code word select the code word and commit to it. The language of collaboration. Words have power, and they are used, how they are used, can lead to collaboration or to disrespect. Insulting and judgmental terms are so ingrained in our practice, everyone else has used them, that we often don't realize how the terms are perceived by others. For example, we use the terms such as order among healthcare professionals and with our patients and families. But what does it reflect? It reflects a military hierarchy which doesn't exist in healthcare. A word such as prescribe better suits today's healthcare interprofessional team. Another term is noncompliant. It is usually used for patients and families who don't do what we want them to do. The term again is hierarchical, and it infers that there is punishment for not doing something. It's judgmental and it's derogatory. The term noncompliant does apply if there's a penalty for not doing something, such as when you don't pay your taxes on time or you don't renew your professional license, but it has no place in a respectful collaboration with our patients and families. A third example from this list is the term frequent flyer. It is usually used for patients and families who repeatedly return for care that the healthcare team doesn't consider justified. The term is derogatory and deleterious to a partnership, though. Instead, when patients and families return more than expected, what we should be doing is an assessment to see, you know, determine what were the patient and family barriers to managing their health or accomplishing what was originally agreed to. Language, though, is not just verbal. It's also physical. When we stand over our patients, families, and colleagues, we present a hierarchical dominance that is a barrier to communication. Crossing one's arms in front, leaning on walls when we speak or listen, playing with one's hair, chewing gum. There's so many behaviors that are common in our daily settings, yet may be perceived as rude, inattentive, or closed off. These conversations are referred to as difficult and crucial conversations because they are emotionally charged. There may be a power differential between those having them, and there is often a fear of retribution, as Rita mentioned, for expressing one's feelings and perceptions. But difficult conversations are just that. They're difficult. They take courage to participate in from both the giver and the receiver's perspective, but they must occur. They're crucial so that true communication and collaboration can be reached. Silence does not support change. They occur at all levels of an organization and between every profession. Of the many terms that can be used for these conversations, we suggest that you use the term respectful conversations for difficult situations to keep our goal of civility at the forefront. Numerous authors have recommended approaches to these difficult, crucial, and respectful conversations, and each approach manages the conversation through a series of steps. Regardless of the steps of their author, these conversations are a skill to be learned, just as we learn to take a blood pressure, complete a history and physical examination, or write a business plan, and just, if not more, important. In our approach, we use a series of 5 steps to the conversation. These steps are available on a pocket card that can be downloaded from the Courage Bucket and laminated, put on stock paper, and laminated for durability. In the near future, we are going to have video vignettes and a facilitator's guide to help guide you to train your students, your faculty, your nurses, and your leaders in this difficult skill to acquire. The Renewal Bucket. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, "What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us." A critical incident is any highly stressful life experience perceived by the person in the situation. What is perceived as stressful for one person is not necessarily perceived as stressful for another. The key determinant is if the stressor has the power to overwhelm the person's ability to cope. Repetitive incidents are especially draining to an individual's ability to cope. So key to any organization's ability to prevent and reduce stress in its workforce is to provide the staff, the students, with programs and resources to address this stress and to identify and remove the inciting stressor. In this case, it's incivility and bullying from occurring. Critical incident stress management is a program provided usually for emergency departments and intensive care units. It is one such program, though, that can be used for reducing the stress and its effects. Schwartz Center for Compassionate Healthcare, Schwartz Center Rounds, are dedicated to promoting compassion and understanding between patients and caregivers. The Schwartz Center for Compassionate Healthcare is a nonprofit organization founded in 1994 by the family of Kenneth Schwartz, a successful Boston lawyer who was unexpectedly diagnosed with terminal cancer in his early 40s. The center is dedicated to honoring Ken's memory and encouraging the kind of compassionate and patient-centric healthcare which was of great comfort to him during his final days. 320 healthcare facilities in more than 35 states are now offering Schwartz Center Rounds on a regular basis. These programs offer healthcare providers regularly scheduled breaks from their difficult and stressful work lives to talk about the social and emotional issues that arise from caring for patients, and it's in a safe and supported environment. Unlike your usual grand rounds, the focus of short center rounds is the human dimension of healthcare, what we're talking about today. Caregivers have an opportunity to share their experiences, their thoughts, their feelings on thought-provoking topics drawn from actual patient experiences. The rounds are based on the understanding that healthcare professionals are better able to connect with colleagues and patients when they have a broader understanding of their own feelings and emotional responses. Perhaps the most important feature of the program, and the reason we bring it up, is the interprofessional dialogue that occurs. Diverse professions make up the panelists who participate in the sessions, and these can include physicians and nurses and social workers and psychologists, allied health professionals, chaplains, students. After listening to a panel's brief presentation on an identified case or topic, caregivers in the audience are invited to share their own perspectives on the case and the broader related issues. Schwartz Center rounds invite caregivers to reconnect with why they entered the profession to begin with. One might say that these rounds connect the knowing with the doing. Healthcare organizations could use Schwartz Center rounds as a venue to discuss specific bullying and incivility cases. But whether you're in an academic medical center, a community center, a college of nursing, a college of medicine, regardless of where you work, we all have employee assistance programs. And recognizing that personal problems, home problems, can impact work performance, health, and well-being is crucial and may be the underlying cause of an incident of incivility or bullying, especially if it's repetitive. So you may have to refer some of your patients to your patients or staff or students to your EAP programs. But this is our renewal bucket too. And part of renewal has been described very eloquently by Parker Palmer in Let Your Life Speak. The Courage and Renewal Centers located throughout the U.S. bring this work to life through facilitated groups, safe circles of trust, and guided imagery and poetry through a group of trained facilitators. The purpose of the work is to help those in caring and service professions to be grounded in who they are, inside or out, their authenticity, to create a powerful connection between the inner and outer person that allows them to live more fully, to have the courage, and to be renewed. Parker Palmer described his work as, "Is this the person the same on the inside as he or she appears to be on the outside?" Children ask this about their parents, students about their teachers, employers about their supervisors, patients about their physicians, and citizens about their political leaders. When the answer is yes, we all relax, believing that we are in the presence of integrity and feeling secure enough to invest ourselves in the relationship and all that surrounds it. And this is the goal in our organization, is a culture of civility and respect. So as nurse leaders, what is our responsibility? As you can see here, it's to our employees, it's to our students, it's to our public, to provide work environments that are free from abuse and harassment. When workplace bullying has been identified, we must swiftly provide appropriate action to ensure the abuse stops. The perpetrator must be held accountable. Bystanders must be acknowledged. And steps are taken to ensure bullying does not occur again. Remember, we are judged by our cultures, and culture is transparent. Policies and procedures must be implemented and enforced to ensure that we all feel safe to report the incidents of the incivility and bullying. So this is a call to action. You've just heard that incivility and bullying, it inhibits building and sustaining a culture of respect. It is detrimental to optimal patient outcomes. All of us, regardless of our profession and where we work and at what level in our organizations we are, must identify, intervene, and prevent workplace bullying. A lot of this is not an inherent skill. We have to train people how to do this. So we must learn to address incivility in the workplace. We need to build it into our curriculum, and we need to build it into our orientation. So the toolkit we have for you at stopbullyingtoolkit.org and stopbullyingtoolkit.com is a start to provide you those tools. It is an expandable toolkit, and we will continue adding things as we can. October is Anti-Bullying Month, and it's a good time for everyone to take their civility pledge and to commit to doing one thing. So, Rita, and my challenge to you today is when you leave this webinar and you go back to your organizations or to your faculty, to your staff, to working with your other professions, is that you at least commit to do one thing. And we hope that we've given you a variety of things to choose from. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Beth and Rita. Now we will take the time to answer any of the participants' questions. We'll give you a few minutes to write your questions in the question box. A few more minutes. Okay, it doesn't look like we have any questions, but Rita and Beth, is it okay if I put your contact information in our follow-up email after the webinar in case any questions arise?
Yes, I'm more
than
happy.
That'll be fine.
Any questions?
Okay, great. So yeah, I'll put the Rita and Beth's email in the follow-up email that I will be sending, and then I'll also have the survey. So everyone just remember to fill the survey out, and you'll get your CEs from there. Thanks so much, Beth and Rita. We really enjoyed your webinar, and it was really great.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Doing it for you. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.
That's coming.